But the idea is that justice is supposed to be objective in many ways, and people are not seeing the U.S. Supreme Court as objective as they should be. I have certain concerns about a court that's comprised of justices who have not practiced criminal law, and yet they are making major decisions around criminal law and criminal justice. And that's a concern. I think perhaps the Supreme Court justices are so sequestered, they don't really understand how their decisions affect day-to-day life.
I want to
give you two examples.
Okay.
One is the Florence case, and this is a New Jersey case, and some of you may be familiar with the case of Florence versus Burlington County. Of course you are. It's the one in which you have Albert Florence, who was in his car, and he was picked up. Yes, the strip search case. He was picked up for a fine he had already paid, and he was taken to a local Burlington County jail. He was strip searched. This African-American male was actually strip searched twice. He was made not only to shower with de-lysing powder, but he was also made to squat, to cough, and many of you guys know what I'm talking about.
Yep.
Okay, and ways to reveal whether or not he was hiding anything in any of his cavities. And he had to go through this twice for a non-criminal fine. The U.S. Supreme Court was then asked to rule whether or not this was a violation of his Fourth Amendment rights, and they said, the court said no. So now, just like Plessy versus Ferguson, local jurisdictions across the country can strip search anyone who's been detained and put in the general population of their local jail. Anyone, man, woman, or a child, may be strip searched. So when I talk about the Supreme Court, what makes me excited about it is the fact that I want other people to watch the court, watch the decisions, and realize that Florence decision affects your life. Because at this point, we have the extension of, I have to say it, slave catchers, etc., with stop and frisk.
Right.
Yes. So I'd like, you know, from slave catchers to stop and frisk. New book title. Okay? Because when I'm looking at the idea of stop and frisk, it goes back to this sense of, we are suspicious of you standing around. We're suspicious of you acting in your own free will. Just being able to walk down the street, drive your car, whatever you're doing, you need to be checked. We need to understand that you are not a danger to us. We want to put you in our system, our criminal justice system. If nothing else, put your name in. And the idea of the humiliation, there was an article in the New York Times not too long ago about women who are stopped and frisked by male officers. And their pocketbooks gone through. All of this is taking place. For teachers, I would like your students to know, don't wait until it happens to you. Understand that this is happening to other people. If we give people the power to let it happen to people of color, pretty soon it's going to get to the other people as well. Law is not race-based on its face anymore. They might draft a law called the Anti-Terrorist Act, and we're thinking, oh, it's just for people who look a certain way. The law is on the book and can be expanded to be used against anyone. So we have to keep these things in mind, that as we consider the U.S. Supreme Court, it's a third co-equal branch of government that has just as much power as the president, just as much power as Congress, and it's only 9 people.
Not objective, as you would think it should be. I don't believe it.
As a matter of fact, a recent poll has indicated only 44% of people believe the Supreme Court is objective. Yeah, they only 44% believe, and that's the lowest rating they've had in the last 25 years.
I would like to know, is there a list of the corporations that utilize the penal system?
I don't know if there's a list, but Doug in his research knows of some of the corporations. And, you know, and I think that, you know, some of them are based in Atlanta, like Coca-Cola, you know, some of the banks in Atlanta. They were, you know, their family descendants were involved in, you know, the penal system. So Doug Blackman knows. He definitely knows, you know.
And then the city government. Because that was another way for city governments to rebuild after the war, and then they liked it and said, we're going to continue this. And so you have these municipalities, and also the interesting part about the descendants, white and black descendants, is the fact that I've had many people, you know, concerned about my stance on a particular issue here or there. But one concern that they've had is the laws that have been put in place, for example, affirmative action that was discussed earlier by the professor. The laws have been put in place like affirmative action. You have immigrants who may say, but my family wasn't here during that time period, so why should I have to deal with affirmative action? You have people talking even about the penitent system, you know, but my family didn't do it. But to actually see a descendant of the family and see they're doing pretty well because they have the inheritance that's been actually given to them over time, what was earned on the backs of those incarcerated men is now the dowry of the great-grandchildren. I don't see them giving anything back. I'm not saying they have to, but I'm looking at this, just that's the closest example that you can see of how discrimination has gone through generations and benefited generations who can say, I honestly had nothing to do with this. But you still are benefiting from the system. This is a direct way to look at it. Other ways are much murkier. But this is one direct way for one to see how they have benefited generationally down the line. And there are many, many other ways. But I think it's something that we have to look at. The benefit to some, and as I've said, it's like, well, you know, if Brown v. Board of Education in 1954 spoke of this sense of inferiority that should not have been based on or placed on the shoulders of blacks, it should not be based in reality, then weren't whites given a false sense of superiority? And if blacks are still carrying this sense of inferiority, are whites still carrying this false sense of superiority? And these are things that we have to wrestle with, not just as teachers, but as you see the young people buying into the system, what do you do? If they buy into a false sense of superiority, and you see some people of color buying into, even like, I teach at John Jay College, so in New York City, I have everybody from all over the world. And I have Asian students who never knew that there was a Chinese Exclusion Act in this country, in which Chinese were forbidden from coming to the country, and once they were here, from being citizens. So this whole idea of Asians being the model minority, it's like, wow, because you didn't stand up and say something, when actually you did. But they have not taught you the times that Asians, Chinese and others, have stood up, Japanese and others have stood up and protested, nor have they talked about the protests of Native Americans, because they want people to be basically docile and believe that black people are the only ones causing trouble.
Right. Thank you. Someone has a hand.
To dovetail on your point, since there is documentation of companies or individuals that participated in this punitive system, do you know of any class action suits or anything filed on behalf of the victims from their relatives seeking some type of monetary compensation, or is there any discussion of this?
I think that's an excellent question, and there should be. And I was looking at it from the standpoint, if we can go back to these priests who abused these boys 20, 30 years ago, then why can't we open up these other cases?
Yes.
Why can't we go back? And maybe we can't go all the way back to the 1930s or 1901. Because one thing that I've seen happen time and time again is they say, but that was law. That was the law at the time. Slavery was the law. Escaping from slavery was a crime. So when they say that segregation was the law, so if you fought against segregation, you were breaking the law, I think my concern is that they're going to say that was the law at the time or something like that. But I do think there should be a way to go back and review whether or not we could, you know, bring some type of action.
But you need a Rosa Parks or Herman Plessy, someone to stand up and do that.
And you have those relatives, so and that evidence. So I think it's interesting. I think our young Harriet Tubmans in the room, our young Frederick Douglasses, our young John Browns, in the room, I think it's very important that we understand when we talk about race in different ways that there have always been people who weren't in the oppressed group standing up for what was right. Always. In my book, Race, Law, and American Society, 1607 to present, I go back to the 1600s. And there were people then, there were white people standing up for those people who were enslaved. There were black people standing up for the Native Americans. You know, there were other people standing up for the Asians. It wasn't just the people in that group standing up, or we'd never get to this point. There have always been people from other groups standing up as well for what was right. And even if some of them lost heart halfway through, or became political cowards, I mean politically afraid, then...
John Brown.
Yeah, John Brown, or a punk. But even when John Brown was facing death, he said this is how he wanted to live his life. He was willing to give his life for that. And I'm not saying people have to give their lives, and you don't have to really give your careers. You can be weekend warriors.